All right. Good morning and welcome, distinguished guest speakers, esteemed panelists, and dear participants. Today is the second day, first session of our international virtual conference, jointly organized by ODA Research and Development Association, as well as Ankara Düşünce ve Araştırma Merkezi. It is 15th conference. So in this today's session, we have a very interesting guest speakers as well as panelists. And the theme of this year's virtual conference is the past, present, future of multidimensional East Africa-Turkey relationships. I hope the guest speakers as well as the panelists that will present their speeches and the papers will serve this theme very well. Accordingly, we have three keynote speakers. First, Her Excellency Ambassador Yaprak Alp, Ambassador Designate of the Republic of Turkey to Federal Democratic Republic of Ethiopia, as well as Permanent Representative to the African Union, will deliver the first speech. Second, His Excellency Mr. Wundumu Gezahan, the Consul General of the Federal Democratic Republic of Ethiopia in Istanbul, in representing Ethiopia's mission to Turkey. Third, Her Excellency Mr. Lelise Uga, Commissioner of the Oromia Tourism Commission, will deliver the final keynote speech. After the keynote speeches, we will have four panel papers. The first panel paper will be presented by a young scholar and diplomat, Mr. Nagao Mamo. His paper is entitled Revitalization of Ethio-Turkish Economic Relations in Post-Millennial Era. And the second paper will also be presented by another young scholar, Wagari Kabata, from Wollaga University. His paper is entitled Ethiopian-Turkish Economic Diplomacy, Trends, Threats, and Future Prospects. And third, from the same university, another researcher by the name Tasfai Fikadu, will present his paper entitled Determinants of Export in East Africa, a Heterogeneous Panel Data Analysis. And finally, a young female student from Marmara University, Shakira Ahmed, will present a paper entitled An Assessment of Trade Relations Between Turkey and East Africa in the Past 20 Years. So these are the key note speeches as well as the papers that will be presented. Without further ado, I will introduce our first guest of honor who will deliver the keynote speech. Accordingly, our guest of honor is Her Excellency Ambassador Yaprak Alp. Before her assignment to Ethiopia as Ambassador Extraordinary Plenipotentiary to Federal Democratic Republic of Ethiopia and Permanent Representative to the African Union, Ambassador Alp served various positions at Ministry of Foreign Affairs of Republic of Turkey and its missions in Belgium, Ukraine, the European Union, United Nations Permanent Office at Geneva. Her over two decades of diplomatic experience with the European Union and her current position as Ambassador to Ethiopia and in particular her permanent representativeness to the African Union makes her speech very unique because Republic of Turkey is one of three African Union strategic partners, designate strategic partners. So China, India, and Turkey are one of the emerging powers that have been recognized by African Union in 2008. And Turkey is a very active participant in the politics, economy, and diplomacy, as well as humanitarian services in East African country, including in Ethiopia, in Somalia, in Djibouti, Kenya, every East African country, they've got embassies. So Turkey is very active, plays a very active role in that region. Therefore, the speech of Her Excellency Ambassador is very timely and we cannot expect anyone else more qualified than the ambassador. Without further ado, I will invite Ambassador to deliver her speech. Thank you very much for.
Thank you. Do you hear me?
Yes, yes.
Okay. Thank you very much for your kind words. Thank you for inviting me to this panel discussion, and thank you for inviting me as a keynote speaker. I have been in Ethiopia now for the past a little bit over 2 years, and I have to say that for anybody, for any nationality, but especially for Turkey, it's an honor to be posted in this country, not just because of the African Union, but because Ethiopia is such an important country in its region, in the world, and it is pivotal. It is pivotal. It has always been pivotal. It is also even more pivotal at this point in time. And it's a great pleasure for me to be here as an ambassador of a very, very friendly country. So when I first arrived here, I realized that already that my job would be easy because the people of Ethiopia love the people of Turkey, and it's a mutual thing. The people of Turkey also love the people of Ethiopia. So there's this people-to-people connection that's been there for hundreds of years already. So the only thing I have to do is build on that and make sure that it becomes even stronger. To this year, we celebrated just 2 months ago, the 125th, this is the 125th year of our relations between the two countries. And so you can see how strong it is, the diplomatic relations, of course. Relations between the empires go back hundreds of years. The diplomatic relations started in 1896, and in 1912, it's a very nice thing. Turkey, the Ottoman Empire at that point, of course, opened a consulate in Harar, which is a beautiful building now, and it stands as a testament to our strong relations. It's been restored by Turkey, and I urge everybody who's in Ethiopia to go and see it. It's a testimony to our beautiful relations. And then Addis Ababa was the first sub-Saharan embassy that Turkey opened in 1926. So really, before anybody else was here, just with a few other countries, Turkey was here opening an embassy, again showing our strong relations. When we talk about Turkish-Ethiopian relations, the first thing that comes to people's minds is more the economic side, the investment side, the business side, the trade side. But there's a lot more, but I cannot go on before first talking a little bit about this, because it's true, it is an important part of our relations. Turkish businessmen and businesswomen came flocking here before many others did. They opened huge factories, they gave employment to tens of thousands of Ethiopians, they gave technology, they gave transfer know-how, and they were very proud to be able to participate in the development of Ethiopia, and that still goes on. Just to give you a figure, Turkey's investment in all of sub-Saharan Africa is $6 billion. Only in Ethiopia is almost half of that, $2.5 billion. So you see the importance that we attach to this country in terms of that, and how our businessmen and women are still flocking to this country. They're employing 30,000 people and really engaging in the development of the country. Trade has been going up a lot. I think Ethiopians realize the quality of Turkish goods. They tell me, I'm not going to name other names, but they look at a good from another country, and then they see a good from Turkish country, from Turkey. They say, I'll buy this one because this will last longer. And that shows in the amount of trade that's been going up. We're at $600 million, up from 200, 300 a couple of years ago. And now we're trying to get this up to $1 billion as soon as possible. His Excellency, Deputy Prime Minister and Minister of Foreign Affairs, Demek Akkanan, was in Turkey mid-February, and that's when the two ministers decided that it should go up to $1 billion. And that visit was also very important politically. It was a kind of refreshing of political relations, which was very important, because Turkey and Ethiopia, both being regional powers, both being important actors also on the global stage, both suffering and fighting against terrorism, both being huge open-hearted countries that invite in refugees, that take them in, they have a lot in common. And so these political relations are also very important. And we're honest friends, both of us honest friends. We're there in each other's day of need, and we speak the truth to each other. That is very, very important, I think. And so we're seeing this also, we're trying to take this forward in the people-to-people relations as well. Turkey gives more than 100 scholarships a year to Ethiopian students. They go and study in Turkey, and they become huge bridges, very important bridges between the two countries. They come back to Ethiopia, and they speak, like me, on behalf of Turkish-Ethiopian relations, which is a very good thing, and I hope this will continue. Humanitarian-wise, of course, Turkey has always tried to help Ethiopia in the way that Ethiopia wants. So we're always very respectful of the country's needs and the country's requests. That's how we do this. But there's been humanitarian aid, food aid, etc., all throughout these years. And then now we're also helping the ongoing humanitarian situation in Tigray, again, according to the government's requests. And we've done two huge projects in Ethiopia. One is the Harar Consulate General that I told you about, which is now working as a cultural center. And we also restored the Najashi tomb in Tigray. We handed it over last year to the Ethiopian government. It unfortunately underwent a few problems now in the last conflict, but we will be there to support its reconstruction, some renovation when the time is right. So just to say that the two countries have been by each other, and we will try to keep this friendship as strong and even stronger than ever. Then, of course, there's the African Union thing, issue that you talked about. Turkey, for the past two or three months, if you've been following the international media, you will have seen there are so many articles about Turkey's involvement in Africa, in all the major international news outlets. Everybody's looking at this. And everybody's trying to ask, well, what is Turkey's objective in Africa? What are they trying to do? The thing is, we don't have any ulterior objective. We don't have secret aims, nothing. What we're doing is what we're thinking, and what we're thinking is what we're doing. So we're on here on the continent as an equal to equal partner with respect. We're doing business, investment, trade. Those are very out there. And when there's a need, when we're trying to, of course, increase our political dialogue, there are many visits. We've opened now 44 embassies in Africa. So with almost every country, we have direct relations. And anyway, we're accredited to all of them. Turkish Airlines flies almost everywhere on the continent. Our TICA, Development Cooperation Agency, is there everywhere. And we believe that Africa is obviously a rising star. And we want to be there as a friend, as an ally, as a partner, in order to help and for mutual support, equal to equal. We are one of the strategic partners of the African Union, and we're very active there. We hope to have a Turkey-Africa Union summit this year in 2021, if COVID allows. And I think we have so many projects, so many, many projects on the pipeline that we want to realize with the African Union. And we're hoping that with this summit, when we are able to talk to our African partners, we will be able to make these go forward as fast as possible. It's in all fields, political, security, economic, cultural, humanitarian. Turkey tries to be active on all these fronts. And that's where we think we can go forward. Turkey needs Africa, Africa needs Turkey. I think this is the start of a very good potential, very good partnership in the future. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Your Excellency Ambassador Yaprak Alp. That is very succinct keynote speech that touched upon the bilateral people-to-people as well as content-to-Turkey relationship. Thank you very much. The second keynote speaker is here online. The speaker is Excellency Mr. Wundimu Gazahan. He has been a member of Ethiopian House of People's Representative and served the Ethiopian people in government for over 30 years. So without further ado, I will invite His Excellency Mr. Wundimu Gazahan to deliver a keynote speech on behalf of the Ethiopian mission in Turkey. Welcome, sir.
Thank you for having me. Good morning, everybody. Esteemed academicians, experts, member of the ORDA Research and Development Associations, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen. At the outset, let me express my gratitude to the ORDA for organizing this virtual conference, which is aimed to deliberate over the Ethiopia-Turkey relations. As you all may know, Turkey and Ethiopia have a long existing political, economic, and social relations. The first diplomatic contact between our two countries dates back to 1896 with the exchange of delegation during the reign of Sultan Ahmed II of Turkey and Emperor Menelik II of Ethiopia. Ethiopia is the first nation in sub-Saharan Africa where Turkey started diplomatic advent by opening its first consulate general in Harar in 1912 and its first embassy in Addis Ababa in 1926. Since the commencement of our diplomatic ties in the 19th century, our relationship has been friendly and collaborative. We share similar perspectives and interests in a various regional and international issues. Moreover, we support each other and stand together in times of difficulty. Turkey was one of the few countries that supported Ethiopia during its struggle against colonization and has a big place in the hearts of the Ethiopian people. Whenever we celebrate the victory of Adwa, we always remember the support we received from Turkey. Over the 125 years of diplomatic ties, our two countries have extended numerous high-level visits that produced very important outcomes which enhanced the development of joint cooperation on both sides. Turkey hosts more than 3,000 Ethiopians, and the government also provides undergraduate and postgraduate scholarships for more than 100 Ethiopian students annually. As of 2020, 632 Ethiopian students have been awarded scholarship at the various Turkish universities. Turkey and Ethiopia also have ever-growing economic ties. Currently, Turkey is one of the largest foreign direct investment in Ethiopia with more than 250 registered and 150 actively operational companies with an investment that worth $2.5 billion USD in textile, construction, manufacturing, and agro-process sectors. These investments rather opening job opportunity, they transferred technology, management skills, etc. to Ethiopians. Turkey also have a good trade relationship with Ethiopia with trading volume of over 600 million USD. Ethiopia exports agricultural products, mainly oil seeds, spices, and coffee to the Turkish market and imports manufactured goods like textiles and garments, metals and metal products, pharmaceutical and chemicals and electrical equipment from Turkey. Our government has a great interest to boost economic ties with Turkey through attracting more Turkish investments and further strengthens trade ties. Since Turkey is a strategic partner to Ethiopia, it is always in the interest of our governments to further strengthen the multifaceted ties with it. The recent inauguration of Ethiopian embassy in Ankara is the implication of the unwavering interest of Ethiopian towards Turkey's friendship relation. Finally, I would like to express my conviction that the outcome of this conference will add up to the existing strongest relationship between Turkey and Ethiopia. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Your Excellency, Mr. Wundimu Gazan, for that keynote speech that touched upon historical relations over 100 of years between Ethiopia and Turkey, as well as its current evolving relationship, and your appreciation for our organization international conference. Thank you very much. Your standing with us is a very huge energy for us to go forward in bridging Turkey and Ethiopia's relations as well. Thank you very much for honoring that. And then our third keynote speaker will be Her Excellency, Mr. Lalise Uga, Commissioner of the Commission of Oromia Tourism Commission. You are welcome, Madam, to deliver your speech.
Okay. Thank you so much. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Probably so. Yeah. Okay. Thank you so much for having me. I feel so honored speaking among the scholars. I've been following the conversation since today, and excellent presentations. I want to say a big thank you to ORDA, the research organization, and also I feel honored speaking in the presence of the two ambassadors. Okay, so.
I think your microphone, okay, now it's turned on.
Hello, can you hear me?
Yes, now we can hear you.
So you didn't hear me before?
It was I'm muted sorry. For some time.
I bad. Say it, I feel.
Yeah,
it's so speaking amongst the scholar. But you have heard my
video. Ramsani, video. Ramsani.
One, right? Okay. All right. So I think between the relationship between Ethiopia and Turkey has been sufficiently covered by Aram directly on tourism. Can you pass the slide to Ethiopia Africa? Short video. Video answer here, Abba. Enjoy the video. Video answer. Hello, can you hear me?
Yes, we can hear you.
Hello?
Please continue.
Okay, so Ethiopia, all right, within the region of East Africa in terms of tourism, but Ethiopia has as one of the five macroeconomic pillars, which gives us an opportunity to utilize sufficiently. So please, the next slide. Sadiq is managing my slide. The next slide. Hello, please. The next slide, please. Yeah. So, saying that, I will get into the potential of our region. As you can see, there is a saying, Bunafi Nagahin Avina, meaning be blessed with coffee and peace, or don't lose. Coffee and peace. So Oromia is one of the regions where there is a coffee heritage. And there is a legend that coffee is found in Oromia or in the neighboring region, SNNPR. So we have lots of coffee for us for anyone who wishes to visit Oromia. Nature-based tourism lovers, and anyone who wishes to come, there are lots of highlight parts. We know that there are so many Islamic heritage within the region as well. And related to Islamic heritage, we believe it more than Sheikh Hussein, which is more than 700 years. There are so many heritage which is common for Turkey and Ethiopia. And the region has registered in UNESCO, especially the Geda, it is a very nice system. Tourism promotion efforts, we call it the region land of diverse beauty because it offers lots of diverse natural resources. All can see the photo behind. We know Turkey has, in fact, yesterday, the two professors were mentioning a lot about Al-Habashi or Najashi. So there is that kind of strong tie between Turkey and Ethiopia. But there is also another shrine, Islamic heritage site, which is Dur-i Sheikh Hussein in the southeastern part of Oromia. We believe that is that offers lots of diversity, including religious diversity of the country. I hope we will work on this together. Next slide, please. Yeah. Yesterday, also, the professors have mentioned Harar being one of the four holy cities or very prominent Ergi and Redwa. That is also something we, it is 15.5 kilometers long, and there is a river going through the cave system. It's the largest, so I hope we'll be working on that to bring visitors and also to share experience in terms of developing the destinations we have. Next, please. Next.
Your microphone is okay. You are back now.
Okay, there is also palaces which are historical sites, including Juma Abba Jafar. We have found above 4,000 meters above sea level. Bali Mountains National Park, the one you see behind the screen is Sanati. It's called Sanati, 4,000 meters above. It's a beautiful place. I hope you get to visit it. Okay. So we have so much wildlife, bird life, flora and fauna, diverse climate. Wolf is also endemic to Bali Mountains National Park. We have so much to offer in the region. Okay. The slide.
Continue, please.
Some of them around 2000 attitude. Okay. Slide, please. I can't see the slide, I'm sorry. Hello? Hello?
It's audible, we can see it. I don't know how you don't see it, but it's talking, there are a number of places in which potential for balloon safari. That is where it is now.
Okay. Yeah, now I can see. Okay, now I can see. I'm sorry. My connection is bad. The one you see is wildlife. And there's a huge potential for balloon safari. And I know Turkey has a special city, Cappadocia, if I'm not mistaken, for air balloons and other adventure activities. So there is a potential in our region, but we need to work on turning that into tourism activity. Okay, next slide. Okay, so what can we work together with Turkey? Generally, as a country, as Ethiopia, but especially within the region. Our tourism commission is just 9 months old. That's a new organization reporting directly to the president's office. Very, very limited work in terms of promoting tourism. Potential of the region and also destination development. So we'll be working on that. So we would like Turkey to support us in experience sharing to help us model our tourism development because it's a huge tourist attraction country. I myself have had clear I would do that. COVID. So we can work together on tourism promotion. Sorry, you changed the slide. Can you get back to where we can work together with Turkey? Okay, finished by saying there are lots of areas we want to collaborate with Turkey, both in promotion and also to destination development. We have so many incentive-based areas within the region. Bali Mountains National Park, Rift Valley Lakes, and Wanchi Dandi areas are highly incentivized for foreign direct investment. So any tourism-related investment is most welcomed. And also we can work on Islamic heritage because there are so many, so many heritages which we can work together. We can work on people-to-people relationship and anything else. So thank you so much. I have one or two videos, just 1 minute video, which can show you the potential of the region. Thank you so much.
Okay, thank you very much, Ms. Lelise Ugaz. That was really extraordinary, even if there were some technical issues with the voice. The video say, a lot with regards to both the fauna and flora, as well as cultural heritage that Turkey could learn from. So that is a very nice presentation from you. Thank you very much. I hope the people around here in our embassy, as well as our Turkish participants, I've got loads from what have been presented and therefore work with Oromia Culture and Tourism Bureau as well as with you. Thank you very much. Now, in line with these three keynote speeches, I will directly pass to the panel papers. There are 4 of them for this morning. The first panel paper will be presented by a young scholar and diplomat, Mr. Nagao Mamo. His paper is entitled Revitalization of Ethio-Turkish Economic Relations in a Post-Millennium Era. Mr. Mamo Nagao, as was also yesterday with us, he has got his bachelor and master's degree from Addis Ababa University. He has got training in diplomacy and now he is serving as a consular in Ethiopian embassy at Doha. Without further ado, I will invite Mr. Nagao to present his paper. Welcome, sir. Okay, thank you for a brief introduction and also for the key keynote speakers. Thank you very much. So for interest time, I will directly go to the presentation. I think my sound is clear, and so I'm trying to share.
Yeah, your sound is very clear.
Thank you. Okay. All right, okay. So the title of my paper is, as you can see, Revitalization of Ethiopia-Turkey Economic Relations in Post-Millennium Era and Assessment of Bilateral Trade and FDI and Development Assistance. So this picture shows some of economic relations between Ethiopia and Turkey in recent years. Actually, this one, the top left, the down left shows a recent visit by Ambassador of Turkey in Ethiopia, one of the biggest companies in Ethiopia. So the others are some of the business forum and the economic discussions. So the outline of my paper will be, as you can see, introduction, and then a discussion on basis of bilateral economic relations, legal and institutional frameworks, then indicators, which are actually trade, investment, development assistance, and the challenges and perspectives as well. And finally, I will present the way forward. So following the end of Cold War in 1991, bilateral relations between Ethiopia and Turkey was restored. And since 2002, bilateral economic relations between Ethiopia and Turkey was significantly revitalized. So this study aims to assess the basis, the indicators, trends, challenges, and the prospects of Ethiopia-Turkey economic relations in the post-millennium era. What are the basis for bilateral economic partnership during this period? There are five basic foundations upon which economic partnership is established. This includes globalization, foreign policy, economic structure and performance, and also legal framework and institutional framework. So when we say globalization, actually the increasing interdependencies through exchange of goods and service and through flow of capital and technologies was one of the aspects, particularly in the era, in the area of economic globalization. Foreign policy as well was one of the bases because, for example, Ethiopian foreign policy mentions Turkey as one of its strategic partner and one of...
Sorry, Nago, to intervene. I don't see your PowerPoint.
All right, sorry.
Yeah.
All right. Okay. Sorry for interruption. So the five bases of economic partnership during this period are these: globalization, foreign policy, and the economic structure and the performance, both in Ethiopia and Turkey, are the basis. For instance, to mention some of the foreign policy interests of Ethiopia. It clearly stipulated that Ethiopia needs Turkish investors to invest in Ethiopia. This is clearly stipulated in 2002 Ethiopian foreign policy. On the other hand, there is complementary nature of factors of production. For instance, Ethiopia possesses land and labor, while Turkey possesses capital and technology, which are needed for
FDI inflow. So this demand between the economy also one of the basis for economic interdependencies during this period. The other is legal framework. There are lots of bilateral agreements in area of economy, to mention few. Economic and technical cooperation was signed in 1993. There is also agreement on reciprocal protection and promotion of investment, and also avoidance of double taxation was signed between the two countries. Institutional frameworks include our respective embassies, Ethiopian embassy in Ankara, and also consul in consulate general in Istanbul are working in the investment and trade area. Also the same embassies of, embassy of Turkey in Addis Ababa also promoting investment for Turkish investors. So other institutions like Ethiopian Airlines, Turkish Airlines, TICA, and other quasi institutional bilateral forums such as Joint Commission on Economic Trade Cooperation, Ethiopia-Turkey Business Council, are some of the institutions that hold the current bilateral relations in economic areas. So there are indicators which shows the strengths of the economic partnership. The three most important indicators are trade, foreign direct investment, and development assistance. Trade, the basis for trade was started in 1993, an agreement signed in Izmir between the two states. So it mentions Ethiopia and Turkey need to strengthen bilateral trade relations by creating favorable, competitive, and stable conditions. Actually, the earliest data on the bilateral trade was registered in 1996. And since 2002, bilateral trade between Ethiopia and Turkey exhibited a robust growth. And since last decade, Turkey became one of the major European trade partners of Ethiopia, both in terms of export and import. When we see the structure of trade, I mean the import and export. For instance, during the last 3 years, Turkey is the sixth export destiny and the leading import origin of Ethiopian products from European countries. The main export items from Ethiopia to Turkey include basically agricultural products, which include vegetables and animal products, leather and leather products. Here, sesame product is one of the main import export items for Ethiopia. The main import items from Turkey to Ethiopia include metals and metal products, machinery and aircraft, and also mechanical and electrical devices. So when we see balance of trade, there is actually high trade surplus for Turkey and expanding deficit for Ethiopia. Over the last two decades, the share of Ethiopia's export accounted only for 11.1%, while the remaining 89% constitute import from Turkey. So from this, we can see that expanding trade deficit is one of the structural problems of the bilateral trade relations between the two states. So the main reason for this is there is trade imbalance deficit on the Ethiopian side, which is attributed to price difference between import and export. Also, there is a low production capacity in Ethiopia and a lack of diversification of Ethiopia's export are some of the main structural problems. As you can see, this is trade data, which shows the bottom yellow line shows the expanding deficit. The other top one is the trade volume, which is nearly equal to the import. So this shows the high import from Turkey. And the green line, which is almost linear, shows Ethiopia's export to Turkey, which didn't show high increase during the same period. These are data on Ethiopian and the Turkey trade balance from 2006 to 2020. As you can see, there is some fluctuations, but for most of the periods, there was increase in trade of volume, and it is balanced towards Turkey for this period. And the average, annual average export was 37.5, import was $300 million. And the total volume was 337 on average during this time. And the expanding deficit was minus 262.5 for Ethiopia. The other most important aspect of the economic relation is the investment partnership. So this is one of the most remarkable aspects of the Turkish economic relations. Basically, Ethiopia's economic diplomacy gives priority to recruiting investors. So attracting foreign direct investment constituted a core element of Ethiopia's diplomatic missions abroad, including Turkey. And the Turkish embassy in Ethiopia is also doing the same in terms of finding investment opportunities for Turkish companies. Currently, with investment of capital of 2.5 billion, Turkey is the leading investor in Ethiopia. Ethiopia is also a primary destination for Turkish investor in Africa, and Turkey is the second largest foreign investor in Ethiopia in terms of number. This is for after China. In terms of number, Turkey is the second one. The other important aspect of the investment partnership is job creation by Turkish company. On average, there is 30,000 Ethiopians which are hired in Turkish companies in Ethiopia. So this is the highest number of workers in private sector. The other is regional and sectoral distribution and ownership. Sector distribution shows that most of the Turkish investors in Ethiopia are involved in manufacturing, like 62% of the companies are involved in manufacturing, followed by construction, 14%, and real estate and agriculture. When we see regional distribution, half of Turkish investors are located in Addis Ababa and followed by Oromia, which is 30%, and the multi-regional, more than two states or regional states, 9%, and the remaining are shared among Tigray, Southern Nations, Amara, and Redawa. So some of the largest Turkish companies in Ethiopia include AICA, ELSE, and you can read BMT, ITOR. These are one of, some of the biggest companies in Ethiopia. And also Yapi Merkezi. This is a recent company which has been working on railway construction and one of the largest companies in Ethiopia. So this graph shows on the left sectoral distribution and on the right regional distribution, which shows a big difference. So almost 80% of companies are located in Addis Ababa and Oromia, especially Oromia regional Addis Ababa surrounding special zones and Addis Ababa region. This is basically due to the infrastructural development in this area.
You are running out of time. Try to finish it in 2 minutes, please.
All right, thank you. The other most important aspect is development assistance and humanitarian aid. So development assistance from Turkey to Ethiopia is channeled through TIKA and other UN agencies like World Food Program. So one of the most important figures in here is in 2009, for example, Turkish government donated $1 million to Ethiopia through World Food Program. And also in 2012, Turkey's Exim Bank has provided 1.4 billion to finance the Awash Woldia rail project. Besides, TIKA has also many projects in education, drinking water, health, and other aspects also. In April 2020, Turkey supplied essential medical equipment to Ethiopia. But as compared to the robust bilateral economic partnership, the development assistance is relatively minimal. This is one of the areas that needs to be improved. So there are challenges in the prospect for the economic partnership. The major challenge include trade imbalance, expanding trade deficit, a lack of diversification, and trade fluctuations also. In investment area, there is a lack of advanced infrastructure, also bureaucratic constraints. Global economic crisis and shortage of foreign currency are some of the challenges. There is also prospect because there is ongoing negotiations on bilateral trade, growing Ethiopia's export earning. There is also Ethiopia's attempt to join World Trade Organization, strong social and political interactions. And the recent effort by Ethiopia to liberalize state-owned institutions also one of the prospects. So to mention the way forward, there is a lot of areas, untapped areas, potential area of economic partnership that the two nations could extend their cooperation in future. For example, there is a huge need on the exploitation of water resources in Ethiopia. Tourism sector needs to be shared by Ethiopia, which have, from Turkey, which have huge potential and a demand in these sectors. I can wrap up my presentation here. If you have questions, I will respond.
Thank you very much, Mr. Nago Mamo. Please, dear participants and members of the audience, write down your questions. We'll have time for discussions and questions at the end. So our second paper will be presented by a scholar from Olaga University, Wagari Kabata. His paper is entitled Ethiopian Turkish Economic Diplomacy, Trend Threats and Future Prospects, which is related to the paper that is presented by Mr. Nagao. Wagari has got LLM in International Economics and Business from Haramaya University and Bachelor from Gaziantep University. He is a senior researcher, lecturer, legal aid volunteer at Wollongong University. He has authored a book and peer-reviewed articles. I invite Mr. Wagari to present his paper. His mic is yours, Wagari.
Thank you, Mr. Chairperson, and hello to everyone. I'm greatly honored to meet you all, ORDA family. Can you hear me, please?
Yes, go ahead, please.
Okay, thank you very much. So in the next 10 minutes, I'll be talking about the trends, threats, and the future prospects of the Ethio-Turkish economic diplomacy, particularly from Ethiopia's perspective. So as this rightly mentioned by previous speakers, Ethiopia and Turkey have a strong relationship, which is multidimensional in nature. In terms of investment, it is mentioned that Ethiopia shares the largest investment of Turkey, about 2.5 billion USD is in Ethiopia, and the company has about 150 companies of Turkey are investing in Ethiopia, and about the companies have created about 30,000 jobs for Ethiopians, and these companies basically are involved in textiles, agriculture, and the infrastructure. When we look at Ethiopia's economy, Ethiopia is one of the poorest nations on earth, but also it is referred to as the fastest growing economy, with a population of about 117 million, out of which 39% is young and 56% is the working age population. And currently, the unemployment rate is estimated at about 20%. So nowadays, Ethiopia leads a transitional economy with crucial sectors being dominated by state-owned enterprises, and largely agriculture and labor-intensive manufacturing industries are leading the country's economy. Recent data indicate that imports to Ethiopia are rapidly increasing, whereas exports are decreased. And the trade deficit of the country is estimated at about 2,600 million US dollars. And the national debt of the country is projected to increase to about 64 billion USD in this year. And the IMF predicts the country's economic growth to be about 0% in 2021, this year. The foreign direct investment inflows to Ethiopia is almost decreasing by 24% in 2019. And the country has been ranked 159th out of 190 for the ease of doing business, according to the global report. When we look at Ethiopia's foreign relation, under the country's constitution, the interests of the Ethiopian peoples and the sustainable development are at the center of foreign relations, and Ethiopia adopted this foreign relation instrument in 2020, which focuses building economic and other multidimensional relations with state and non-state actors, basically in the areas of investment, trade, market opportunities, and social-cultural ties. And this economic diplomacy seeks ensuring sustainable and equitable development in the peace. After the coming to power of the current administration of Abiy Ahmed, Ethiopia introduced what is referred to as homegrown economic reform, which are just false expectations. Basically, they are repetitions of what World Bank, IMF, and other similar organizations call for macroeconomic, structural, and sectoral reforms, And basically this instrument refers to the obvious problems by which Ethiopia's economy are characterized, like the shortage of foreign exchange, poor electricity in the internet and the like. So when one look into the details of this homegrown economic reform agenda of the current administration, it doesn't look as homegrown as strongly claimed, but just it is simply the liberalization demands of the global West. When we look at the basic factors, particularly focusing on foreign direct investment, at the heart of factors that determine foreign direct investment is political instability. In fact, there are also other factors that are important. So when we look at the threats from the perspective of political instability or otherwise, Ethiopia is just a country of anti-democratic culture. In fact, even if the current administration is preaching about democracy and the like, actually the country is characterized by internal political instability, and that this instability adds transaction costs to investments and disrupts production and distribution. In addition, the country is also known for unfair distribution of wealth, whereby the poor gets poorer and the rich gets richer. Ethiopia is also known for the culture of heavy reliance on aid in the borrowing. In fact, Ethiopia is one of the world's biggest recipients of international aid. In addition, Ethiopia's economy is also highly hit by currency devaluation, inflation, and other problems. In addition, we are also facing various external threats because of failed diplomacy of the current administration. In addition to that, we have economic marginalization of the people. Basically, Ethiopia is home to over 80 ethnic groups, of which nearly 50% are the Oromos, and that these Oromo are endowed, the Oromia, the land of the Oromo, is endowed with abundant human, material, and cultural resources, and that this region situates at the heart of the country, where estimated 50% and more investment activities operate. And particularly the land, minerals, water, and other important assets required for investment and other economic activities are supplied from Oromia. Contrary to this, the Oromos are neglected by successive dictators, including the current administration, and their share has been just displacement from their homes, environmental pollution, deaths, gross violations of human rights. So these kind of things are hampering the economic diplomacy of the country. In addition, urbanization in the country have been conducted by systematic exclusion of the Oromos, and economic activities have been concentrated in urban areas and rural areas where the majority of the Oromos are living, do not get access to adequate infrastructure, internet, and the like, because rulers of the country actually fear that economically empowered Oromos, and of course, other groups are threats to their power. And the current administration and its predecessors also focus on consolidation of their power, and they rule just only as they wish in the name of this development. When we look at the investment opportunities in the country, particularly from the how the two nations, Ethiopia and Turkey, can strengthen their ties. Obviously, the two nations have strong cultural and religious ties. And Ethiopia is characterized by young working population and a large consumer in the geographical proximity to large consuming countries like the Middle East. And Ethiopia's recent membership to the African Continental Free Trade Area, as well as other opportunities recognized under the domestic national laws, as well as international legal frameworks, could be mentioned as opportunities for the investment in the trade relationship between the two nations. So to sum up, Ethiopia needs a strong and a genuine economic diplomacy with Turkey and beyond, but a lot needs to be done at home, particularly inward-looking approach is required. It is obvious that economic diplomacy doesn't bring a ready-made solution to one's nation. And it has to be mentioned that political stability is the primary determinant of the economic welfare of the two nations. And fostering the economic diplomacy requires first political stability in Ethiopia. As I mentioned earlier, Ethiopia has long experience of acting contrary to democratic principles. In addition, it is important to look at sustainable utilization of available human and other resources, because currently various human resources that the country have are just languishing in prisons, and just most of them are killed by this administration. In addition to foster the economic diplomacy, it is also important for Ethiopia to build one's own model economy, economic diplomacy that doesn't take into account the needs of the rich, but that is inclusive to all nations. In addition,
Mr. Waldori, your time is up. Please wrap it up.
Thank you. Almost, I'm done. So, finally, I would like to say Turkey should support the democratization and the development endeavors in Ethiopia. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Mr. Waldori, for that good presentation of yours. Please, if you have questions, member of the audience, write down your questions so that you will ask at the end of the session. We have two more papers. The next paper will be presented by Mr. Tasfai Fikadu. Mr. Tasfai Fikadu is currently a PhD student. Earlier, he has got Master of Science from Addis Ababa University in Economics, and he has been the head of the Department of Economics at Wollaga University, as well as he has served many years at Mizan Tepe University as an instructor. Without further ado, I welcome Mr. Tasfai Fikadu to present his paper. His paper is entitled Determinant of Export in East Africa, Heterogeneous Panel Data Analysis.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Jiris, for moderating. And I want to thank also the rest speakers and audiences. I hope my voice is audible.
Yes, your voice Hello? Is audible. Mr. Fikadu?
Yes, Fikadu? Yes. Yeah, I'm opening PowerPoint.
Okay.
And I hope it is visible too.
Yeah, you are sharing now. Okay, excellent, it came.
Okay, thank you very much. On the terms of in East Africa, heterogeneous panel data analysis. This is our outline. To begin with, background, the significance of trade for growth and development historically been built on this theory that essentially puts for competitive advantage as is for trade. The share of trade. The share of global export for Africa is declining from time to time.
We are expecting your voice to come. I think his internet would be down. We will wait for him for 1 minute. Let us wait for him patiently for 1 minute. Okay, probably we will entertain Mr. Tasfai's paper if he could. Okay, I think he's back. Mr. Tasfai, can you hear me? Can you hear me, sir? Step this way.
Hello.
Restart.
Yes.
Okay. It is not PowerPoint. I'm looking at your desktop. Okay, can you hear me now? All right, try to fix your connection. In the meantime, for the next 10 minutes, I think Shakira is ready. If Shakira is ready, we can take on Shakira's paper and then we'll come back to you, that's fine. Technical team, please bring on Shakira. Shakira was a market and financial analyst at a company called Nexus at Addis Ababa. She was from Addis Ababa and graduate of Unity University. Currently, she is a master's student at Marmara University in economics. So she is going to provide with us the trade relations between Turkey and East Africa in the past 20 years. If Shakira is ready, our young scholar, member of ORDA, and also financial analyst for ORDA, you are welcome.
Thanks so much, Mr. Idris. Can you hear me?
Yes, it's very audible. Welcome.
Can you see my my presentation?
Yeah, we can see your PowerPoint as well.
Okay, thank you so much. Thank you. Dear guests and members of First Victor ODA members, may my warm welcome reach all of you. Since the given time is limited, I'm going to pass the presentation. And the topic of the study is an assessment of trade relation between Turkey and East Africa from 2001 to 2019. The main objective of this study is to examine trade ties between Turkey and East Africa with a particular reference of import and export volume from 2011 to 2019. Accordingly, the quantitative data research meta is used, and the secondary data sources have been collected from official statistics, and based on that, analysis also made using descriptive and explanatory techniques. Starting from the country's economy, if we see Turkey economy, according to IMF, Turkey is categorized under the emerging market economy, under the upper middle income groups with a population of more than 80 million. As we are seeing in this graph, the Turkey recorded the high GDP volume in 2016, which is $869 billion. Well, when we see the real growth rates of Turkey, as we are seeing in the graph, this graph is showing us the growth rates of Turkey from 2003 to 2020, where the Turkey registered its highest growth rate in 2011, which is 11.2%, and slow growth rate registered during the Great Recession, which is negative 4.8. Since 2009, the Turkey economic growth was somehow fluctuated. The reason for this is that Turkey economy is mainly depend on the foreign policy. Passing to East African country, as we know, East Africa is the fastest growing region in Africa, with the average growth rate of more than 5%. As we can see in the graph, most of East African countries are able to register the growth more than 5%, with the more ability of growth rate in Ethiopia. When it comes to the trade in Turkey, this graph is showing us the total export and import value of Turkey that has been made between 2001 to 2019. Starting 2001 to 2009, both import and export value has been increasing significantly, while during the global crisis period, which is in 2009 and 2010, shows some decline amount and began to increase with the more of export, with the more of import than export value. When we see the Turkey export destination country, Turkey is mainly exporting its products to European country and the Middle near and the Middle East country. While its export destination share with Africa is very low, especially particularly for other African country, which is only 3%. The same for the import partners in 2019 data. Europeans also are the major import partner with Turkey, followed by other Asian country. And still, Africa has a low sharing of trade import trade partner with Turkey, as we are seeing. It's only 1% other than North Africa. Coming to the specific topic, the East Africa, Turkey and East African trade, as we are seeing in the graph, this graph is showing us the total value of export and import that has been made between Turkey and East Africa in the past two decades. Accordingly, starting from 2001 to 2019, both import and export value has been significantly increasing, with the high of import than export, while export imports of East African country from Turkey reached $1.4 billion in 2019, while the export from East Africa to Turkey was only $177 million. When we see based on the country, the most exporter East African countries to Turkey is, are Ethiopia, Kenya, and the latter on Uganda. The same as for the import, Ethiopia became the dominant country importer of Turkey products, which is followed by Kenya and Tanzania. To conclude the study, from year 2001 to 2019, both import and export value of East Africa has been increasing, with a huge gap between import and export value, while East African countries are in net importers. Two-thirds of Turkey's export goes to Europe, Asia, and the Middle East. As we know, Turkey is geographically significant from those regions. And the magnitude of Turkey-East African trade relation is very low compared to BRICS country, especially with China and India, with a 1% export share and only 2.5% import share in 2011. And the other we found from this study, the Turkish products are hardly affordable in East Africa, especially comparing to the Chinese product, and exports of East Africans are still more of raw material, which is a most of grains and minerals and metals. So in order to promote the trade relation between East Africa and Turkey, the strategy that has to be made by Turkey is the Turkey should recommend to have a clear trade policy strategy for African countries, particularly for East Africa. And also it's advisable to have a preferential trade agreement, which makes its product to be affordable in East African market. And the other is, it's also recommended to facilitate visa access for the merchant in order to increase merchandise trade among the regions. While so many improvements are expected from East Africa, such as avoiding their border conflict and working for peace and security, accelerating the structural transformation, especially on the sectoral growth, and properly working on the regional trade blocks like COMESA, East African Commission, and other trade agreements. The other recommended is strengthening the macroeconomic policy, especially related with foreign currency, and finally, improving the finance access, which is particularly based on trade and commerce. Thank you a lot. This all about one I wanted to address to you.
Thank you very much, Shakira, for that very succinct and precise presentation of the paper. Now our panel session, if we could get in touch with Mr. Tasfai, we will bring him in so that he will present his paper. I'm still expecting Mr. Tasfai to come in, but I think his network is not good. So if let us wait for him for one more minute, and if we couldn't go there, we will go ahead with the questions and answers as well as comments. Media now. So we have waited, still we can entertain him if he could come back. Mr. Tasfai, are you back? That's why we can't do. I have seen him and it's lost. So the
network. Sorry for the interruption.
Okay, welcome. Please go ahead if you can.
Okay.
Okay, I couldn't hear you. Come on. Probably check the volume of your microphone.
Sorry, is it visible, Idris?
It was visible. Now it is off. Now your sound is coming clearly.
Can I continue?
Yes, please continue. Try to wrap it up as succinctly as possible.
Okay, thank you very much. As I have said, the title is Determinants of Export in East Africa, Heterogeneous Panel Data Analysis. This is the outline. To begin with background, the significance for growth and development has historically been built on classical theory. The share of global export for Africa is the lowest and declining from time to time, whereas for Asia rising. The success story of developed country, it is attributable to different variables. For Asian tigers, manufactured export led. For China, the competition between domestic and foreign industry. In Europe, deeper trade integration, increased specialization, liberalization policies, decreasing transport costs, and technology associated with export are some variables. Coming into statement of problem, I hope it is hearable.
Yes, it's visible.
Hello,
wrap it up very shortly because we don't have time.
Okay, sorry. East Africa scored the highest economic growth compared to the rest region in Africa for almost decades, while supply side and the foreign demand side of economic growth prompts export, domestic demand side prevents. And this way, economic growth in East Africa is as a result of consumption expansion, especially in high-performing countries. On the other hand, United Nations 2015 revision of world population estimated that Africa's population would double by 2050. In this way, East Africa recorded high population growth. On the other hand, Africa has a lower productivity, especially in agriculture. Moreover, despite this vast agricultural potential, Africa's balance of trade was in deficit, remained a net importer of agricultural products in the last three decades. Hence, it is worth studying determinants of export in East Africa. Study in previous are limited to gravity model and missed important variables. Our study not only incorporates these missed variables, but also with new and different from previous methodology. This way, the objective of the study is to analyze the relationship between export.
I think your voice has gone to sway.
Hello?
Okay, come now.
Okay. To identify export, it is disturbing me, in fact.
I hope if you can hear me, you can just pass to the discussion aspect of your presentation and try to wrap it up because there is some technical errors there. If you can hear me, you can directly go to the discussion part and wrap up your presentation, please. Okay, let us, unfortunately, this technology is not allowing us to hear all the presentation of Mr. Satasfai. I wish we had him and they heard all of his presentation. Unfortunately, we don't have time. Therefore, I decide rather we go to the discussion part. We will have 10 more minutes. The technical team, okay.
Hello?
Okay, hello? Present your result. I was going to end the presentation actually, but if you come in, please finish the result and discussions.
I'm very much sorry. The problem from poor qualities of information. I'm very much sorry. Explain this was an explanation to the beginning.
All right, we will directly pass to questions and comments. You could, the technical team, let you be ready for the questions and answer session. So the questions and comments will be mainly directed to the papers presented by Mr. Nago Mamo, Mr. Wagari Kabata, as well as Ms. Shakira. Therefore, the stage is open, the mic is open for question comments. We have around 10 minutes for that. Anyone who has comments or questions?
May I ask?
Yes, Dr. Junaidi, please come on.
Okay, thank you so much. As usual, I thank all the presenters, the participants and the moderator. Then I will try to ask some questions to the presenters. I think my sound is coming.
Yes, it's clear.
Okay, that's good. To Mr. Nagao, course, concerning the trade activities are being performed well between Ethiopia and Turkey. But I usually hear, especially in our country, about the bureaucracy while the process this trade activity, whether in the customs or in other development organizations, which might hinder these trade relations, what do you comment to mitigate these kinds of hinders as an expert on this? Second question is for Wagari. Would you suggest some strategies how to promote the homegrown products or local products instead of depending on the import products? Is my question. The third question is to Shakira. I think if this is her topic. It is about the strategies of promoting the good trade relations between Turkey and Ethiopia, because when she show us the proportions in graph, in circle graphs, the proportion is very low for when we see the proportion of the trade relationship between Ethiopia and East Africa, the proportion is very low. How strategically we can improve this proportion, which is expected actually for mutual for Turkey and for East Africa. My question, thank you so much.
Okay, thank you very much, Mr. Junaidi. I will have two more questions and comments from the audience. Two more. Dr. Abdul Fattah.
Okay, thank you for giving this chance. I have one question for presenter Nagao. To foster the two regions or maybe specifically the two countries' economic relations. What are the incentives from the both sides, from the Turkish government side and also maybe from Ethiopia or other regions, in order to motivate the stakeholders to increase the trade share between the two regions? It can be maybe, I don't know, what's the current situation in terms of loans provided to the investors and also maybe to the exporters in Ethiopia and in Turkey, and how these incentives are now used by the stakeholders. Do you have any idea or maybe do you have any information on this issue? Thank you.
Another member of the audience who would like to ask or comment. Okay, if we don't have more questions or comments, I will directly pass the mic to Mr. Nago, Mr. Wagari, and Mr. Shakira, respectively.
I raise my hand, Mr. Moderator.
I still didn't see, please come on. Okay, Abu Yusuf, I don't know who that is. Come on, please.
Okay. Thank you so much for the moderator. And I would like to really appreciate ORDA and other stakeholders for this very informative and insightful virtual conference. Really, we benefit a lot from these sessions. Yes, I just want to add some comments and the ideas of Mr. Wagari Kabatu in relation to his paper. It's really a very timely and informative paper regarding the economic diplomacy, as he properly outlined in his introduction part. The attention provided by economic diplomacy by both governments is huge. So we need to properly investigate all the challenges and opportunities in promoting this economic diplomacy and benefit our citizen from this engagements. So in this regard, Mr. Wagari, he outlined the challenges in relation to promoting Ethiopian-Turkish economic diplomacy, especially from the Ethiopian side. I hope it will be more insightful if we have some chances to see again, the challenges and opportunities from the Turkish side as part of his study. My question is, these days, especially the role of non-state actors in promoting countries' economic diplomacy is very huge. And in this regard, the Turkish experience is very prominent. The Turks in various aspects, they have very strong non-state actors and they are becoming the main caliber in promoting Turkish economic diplomacy in various areas. So in this aspect, what are your propositions in promoting the role of non-state actors in strengthening Ethiopia's economic diplomacy towards Turkey as well as other countries. So thank you so much.
Thank you very much, Dr. Muzayyan, for coming in and presenting your question. Now, without further ado, I will give the chance first for Mr. Nagao to comment on his question by Dr. Junaidi. Mr. Nagao, come on.
Okay, thank you. So directly to go to the question, I'm to answer. Bureaucracy is really one of the challenge particularly bureaucratic inefficiency is one of the challenges that I've already mentioned in the study. But there are still ways that we can improve, or the Japan government is also trying its best to improve this challenge, because it hampers trade relations, because this is one of the problem. So the recommendations are clear. This trade, I mean, the bureaucracy must be digitalized, particularly in the areas of trade and investment. So maybe digitalizing and making it efficient is one of the ways that the government, not only at the custom, but also other areas which are related to the process of the trade. There are complaints from traders actually. So it has to be very efficient. There are ways for digitalizing, making one step services or one window services for many processes at, to provide one many services at the same place. These are some of the recommendations that the government should consider, I think. The second question is regarding the incentives. So there are many incentives in the area of trade. I mean, for any traders, particularly who want to be involved in export in selected areas, particularly in agricultural sectors, textile, there are lots of incentives which are provided by government. Like, for example, there is a grace period for tax. Also, there is incentives like importing duty-free for imports which are used for agricultural products. So these are some of the incentives. In addition to that, there is also there is, for example, loan related to bank and the allowance of foreign exchange. So these are some of the incentives which are available in the trade, but most of them are in selected areas, not for all investment, I mean, for not on all sectors, because the government gives priority for some sectors which are underdeveloped. So for traders who are really involved in this area, there is a lot of incentives. Recently, there is also a new proclamation, trade proclamation. So this has also brought many, reforms which will helpful, which are helpful in providing or in clearing the challenges witnessed in the trade areas. So these are some of the reforms. I think I've tried to address your question.
Thank you very much, Mr. Nagao, for the response. And next question would be for Mr. Wagari. Mr. Wagari has two questions from Dr. Junaidi as well as from Dr. Muzayyan. Mr. Wagari, please.
Thank you, Mr. Chairperson, once again. You hearing me?
Yes.
Well, with respect to the first question, basically, it is important that Ethiopia focuses on increasing the production, because in order to substitute the importers, it is highly recommended that we increase the quantity as well as quality of the products that we have. Currently, actually, Ethiopia is importing each and almost everything, starting from food items itself, whereas in fact the country is endowed with abundant resources which are underutilized. So it is highly recommended that it is important to focus on areas where the country is good at. In what areas can we increase the production so that we can substitute the importers that we are doing right now as a country. Current data indicates that by 2050, Ethiopia's population will reach about 200 million. So Ethiopia's population is growing very rapidly, whereas the economy is going downside. So in order to properly handle this crisis, it is important to look at areas where we can be good at, particularly in terms of comparative advantage, particularly the agricultural sector can feed the population, at least from these basic items. If we focus on producing these basic items, at least the country can feed its population and address other issues. But for this to happen, as I mentioned earlier, the first thing that comes to the stage must be ensuring political stability in the country. Even if we have numerous economic and other wellness, if the political stability is not in the proper direction, then there is no way for the country to sustain. Having said so, with respect to the first question, coming to the next one. In fact, non-state actors, as rightly mentioned by the individual who posed the question. By Dr. Muzayin. In fact, it is rightly mentioned that these non-state actors play a pivotal role in just the point is each and every of you just are ambassadors, just you are representing the nation. So just starting from that, you can identify areas where the country is good at, that particularly in Turkey, with a strong cultural and religious ties with the countries. So depending on these kind of areas, it is important for you and for your friends and colleagues to strengthen the tie in areas where we have similar cultural and other ties. The same is true for our other individuals, other segment of our population who are in other countries. But I'm not only talking about individuals who are out there, but also we individuals who are in Ethiopia are also responsible to organize ourselves and focus on promoting what the country is good at, depending on the need of the country with which we need to establish a strong relationship. And this is what I have. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Mr. Wagari. Shakira, you have more questions from the social media. There are three of them. First, from your both import and export in Turkey, East Africa is significantly increasing. Can you say something about the rate of increasing? That is one question. I think you can see it on the Zoom text. So second, the GDP of Turkey at one point is extremely decreasing compared to other years. What is the cause? And third, is your data time series? And before I let you answer the question, I think Misra also raised the hand. If you can provide your question, Misra. I give that because she is one of the youngest scholars here. Otherwise, the time of question is up.
It's not question, just I give like, thank you.
Okay, that's very good. So Shakira, come on.
Okay, thank you. Let me start from Dr. Junaid's question and pass to those written questions. I think Dr. Junaid asked me what is the reason for the Ethiopian to be the more trade partner compared to other East African country, if I'm not wrong. The reason for Ethiopians become a more trade partner with Turkey is, as we know, in the last decade, Ethiopia is able to register the high economic growth compared to other African countries, particularly in the service sector of construction. So Ethiopia was also importing more of construction material from Turkey that are iron and steel and machinery. So relating with the growth of infrastructure in Ethiopia, the import of those material from Turkey is able to increase in the last two decades. Passing to these questions, I think the first question said from your results, both import and export. Both import and export has been increasing as we see in the data in the last two decades, especially with the significant increasing of import at the rate of more than 15%. And while the import, while the export was increasing slowly with less than 10%, and the GDP of Turkey at one point is extremely decreasing and compared to other year. if we see, like, we can divide the growth of Turkey, like, before the Great Recession and after Great Recession. Before the Great Recession, Turkey had its own internal economic crisis in 2011. We can take that one as a reason for the continuous deterioration of their growth up to 2009. And for the 2009 and 2010, we can take the reason of global recession. It's a global recession period. And after that, it has showing somehow fluctuation. So as I have said, the Turkey economy is mainly dependent on foreign policy, in spite of their internal political factors. If we see, we can take an example of the 2018 Turkey product import, double import tariff imposition by USA during the Trump administration. So that one has a huge effect on Turkey economy still now. Since 2018, the Turkish lira has been continuously depreciating, like up to now. So this becomes the more challenge for Turkey in the side of the common macroeconomic indicators such as inflation, foreign currency, and the interest rate. I hope that's the point where the Turkey economy able to down even register around 0.8 something like that in 2019. Yeah. The third question is relating to the data. As we have seen, it's a time series data. It's based on the time. So the trade relation is depending on through time, what was their trade relation between Turkey and East Africa. It's all about time series data. I hope I have tried to answer the questions. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much, Shakira. Thank you, everyone. Guest speaker, I think most of them have left. The panelist has also covered what they have presented and answered question excellently. So we have one more session to go. That session will be moderated by Mufti Qasim. Let the technical team provide us with one music until Mr. Mufti will take on the mic for me. Thank you very much for the first session. Thank you, everyone.
Hello, everyone. Can my voice be heard, please? Can you hear me?
Yeah, I can hear you.
Thank you. Welcome to our last sessions of today's in our conference. To introduce myself, my name is Mufti Qasim. We have two presenters in these sessions, and I will be having the last remarks from our vice presidentes. Our first presenters will be Idris Makonnen. Idris Makonnen is currently a PhD candidate at Istanbul Commerce University with a research interest in secularism, which is separating the state from religion. He also undertakes research on the disciplines of international relations, focusing mostly on the identities of state actors, in line with the constructivist international relation scholarship. He will be presenting his articles entitled Modeling Secularism in the Post-1920 Ethiopian States. Please, Mr. Idris Makonnen, the mic is yours. Continue.
Could you all please see the shared screen? Yes,
you can say it. Please continue on.
Is it full screen or just only the parts of the slides?
No, unfortunately, it's not full screen.
Okay, let me come back.
That would be better.
Yeah, okay. So how it is? So I can only just share you the I cannot make it just a full screen anyway. I hope you can see it in any form. So hello everyone. My name is Idris McConnell. Thank you, the moderator, for this very precise introduction of mine. So today with you, I would like to just have discussion on the topic I framed out as modeling secularism in post 1991 Ethiopian state. So I will, first of all, I would like just to give you the statements I include in the abstract. I would like to read them just as they appear. So the model of secularism, the post 1991 Ethiopian state should practice, has not yet been discussed despite the notion's 3 decades long constitutional prevalence. No previous work gives a comprehensive picture of Ethiopia as a secular state and suggests a model it ought to implement whatsoever. As such, the present undertaking marks a pioneering scholarly endeavor and addresses this gap. This study argues that secularism the Ethiopian state shall implement is born out of the social conditions that mirror the foundation of its existing polity. It sheds significant light on the notion of secularism, employing relevant social realities in post 1991 Ethiopia's polity. The empirical analysis concludes by suggesting a viable model of secularism defined by prevailing social context unique to the contemporary Ethiopian state. But I should put my confession here. The topic I give to this study does not necessarily indicate a comprehensive and finalized model of secularism vis-a-vis the Ethiopian state. It rather brings forward a solid aspiration on the ground of a critically relevant demand for one, and hitherto developing work on the issue that the Ethiopian state ought to adopt. Hence, at this level, the Ethiopian model of secularism has not yet been coined, or I refrain to call so, nor put into the category of the existing mainstream model. So don't expect me just to give you a particular precise and timely model that the Ethiopian state should adopt in order to put the constitutionally enshrined secularism that it aspires to implement. So the contents of this presentation has 4 main parts. I would like first to highlight the seismic change in post 1991 Ethiopia. This is a ground on which we need to take into consideration the secularism that we are talking about in Ethiopian context. And also I would like to highlight understanding the mainstream models of secularism, and also core assumptions which are important to model the Ethiopian state secularism. And finally, I would like just to highlight the model that the secular states of Ethiopia should aspire to. So when I refer to the seismic change, the post-1991 Ethiopia, I was supposed to focus on the events occurred after 1991, but it's also important to give you just a rough or big picture of the formation of the Ethiopian state. So I have the humble understanding of the formation of the Ethiopian state, and I argue that this has come to existence only after 20th century. So since the formation of the modern Ethiopian state, two seismic changes occurred subsequently. The first one, as you all already knew, is a revolution that occurred in 1974. And the second one, I coined it as the reconfiguration, and which occurred in 1991. So the reason why I brought up the revolution that occurred in 1974 is that it has an important input to the introduction of the separation of the state from the religion. So the revolution occurred, but as you all knew it very well, was sabotaged by the men in uniform, and the Marxism ideology was the ideology that the country has been just known by. And the coming two decades were mainly characterizing the country's situation. And obviously we had an end to the established religion, or the established religion that was the Orthodox religion. But despite this divorce between the state and religion, unfortunately the state, as you know, remained hostile and repressive, and a significant history that transformed the end of established religion, that means the divorce, the state was transformed into an oppressive state. Now I came to the post 1991 era. So post 1991 era ushered for me, importantly, a reconfigured Ethiopian polity and a reconfigured Ethiopian state. So at the end of this reconfiguration, identity takes firm hold. And among other important identity marks, religion constitutes the domain of these identity markers. And this bold move towards cementing this reconfiguration was the constitution. So the currently operational constitution, the currently existing constitution, is for me an important move that cemented the reconfiguration of both the Ethiopian state and the Ethiopian polity. So the reconfigured polity has two important characteristics. Then the first one is a multinational reconfiguration of the Ethiopian state. And the second one is the multi-religious reconfiguration of the Ethiopian polity. But unfortunately, the constitutional foundations of the secular states, however, showed no steps forward either to suggest or formulate any viable tool to put the separation of states and religion, or just any form of viable model to put the secularism, the constitutional secularism into practice. This has been obviously acknowledged by the current prime minister when he remarked at one of the events to suggest that the Ethiopian state or our country needs to have a model that help practice or implement the constitutionally enshrined secularism. And one of the suggestions, just small suggestion that he indicated, was either to see the model of secularism practiced somewhere else, for example, in the United States. But the point should come here is that...
Mr. Edis, I'm sorry for the interruptions. Your time allocated was 10 minutes. I apologize for not mentioning it at the beginning. You have left yours 2 minutes only. Please try to finalize your presentations. Thank you.
Okay, thank you for this reminder. So okay, just around the world, in many countries, mainly three mainstream models of secularism have been now implemented. And the first one is just assertive secularism, a kind of secularism that countries like France and, according to literature, Turkey have been implementing, that is quite hostile to religion. And the second one is the passive secularism, a kind of secularism that has been put in the United States. And third one is a kind of secularism that has been put in place in countries like India, and it's called principled secularism. And these three models have been widely discussed by the literature. In my study, I tried to analyze the pros and cons of these forms of secularism. I'm not suggesting either of these models for the Ethiopian state to adopt. I rather suggest a unique, prototypical kind of model of secularism, but that should be based on these important assumptions. The first one is the level of magnitude of religiosity. So it should be understood that religion is in fact the most important organizing social factor in the Ethiopian polity. The second assumption that I rely on to devise the model is the empirical reality that Ethiopia is religiously heterogeneous. And this religious heterogeneity is with a significant proportion of diversity. So diversity must be understood as enmeshed in power relations, and therefore the hidden potential of religion-related domination must be explicitly acknowledged. And also the third assumption is the fundamental conviction that the building up the Ethiopian state has not yet finished and is still in process. The state building or the nation building process has yet not been complete as far as my argument is concerned, and secularism should be taken into consideration to have a complete and better establishment of a nation or nation building. And also there is a colossal social quest for the to have this model of secularism, and also huge support. The kind of model that I am trying to develop as far as the Ethiopian secularism is concerned has these two important features. The first one is the secularism must be institutionalized. None of the secularisms I studied in many other states never been institutionalized. That is the big gap I observed in other countries. For example, I analyzed the constitutions of almost 193 sovereign states, and only 35 of these states openly claimed the state is secular, and more than 180, they just implicitly referred their state as just a state that separates religion from the state, but none of them has an institutional apparatus to openly or explicitly implement the model of secularism that they have introduced to their country. I suggest the Ethiopian state needs to institutionalize the secularism that it's going to adopt. And also, as part of this model, I also suggest this secularism to be part of an integral part of the political discourse. And the analogy can be the consolidation of, or the consolidating process of the democracy in our country, because the secular state is important to the future of Ethiopian democracy itself. When I come to the conclusion of this presentation, I'm just trying to bring forward the importance of modeling a unique secularism that the Ethiopian state should adopt to. And my analysis of models of secularism being practiced elsewhere are important for our understanding of secularism being practiced elsewhere, but Ethiopia needs to have its own model of secularism. And I would like to get your own understanding of the points that I mentioned here, and also from your own experience and readings, so that I can incorporate to my own research, so that at the end of the day, we will have well thought, well articulate, and also relevant model of secularism that the Ethiopian state needs to adopt. Thank you very much for your attendance.
Thank you very much, Mr. Idris Makane, for your very good presentations. Dear participants, if you have any questions, please take your notes. There will be a time allocated for questions and discussions. Thank you, Mr. Idris Makonnen, for your presentations. Our next presenters will be Dr. Abdul Said. He has received his BA degree from Harima University and his MA from Addis Ababa University. He has also a master's in Islamic economics and finance from Stanford University, and a PhD from Marmara University in finance again. Currently, he's a postdoctoral researcher at Islam University. In the past, also he had worked as a lecturer at Olaita Soddo University in Ethiopia. His research areas are mainly focused on financial institutions, markets, and international finance and investment. He will be presenting his paper entitled Participation Banking in Turkey, Lessons to Interest-Free Banks in Ethiopia. I welcome Dr. Abdul Said to the podium, please. The mic is yours, Dr. Abdul Said. You can continue.
Okay. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. And thank you all for inviting me to present my paper on this conference. Can you hear me?
Yes, so please go on.
Can I share my presentation?
I can push the host to help him with the sharing his screen.
Okay, so thank you again. My presentation will be about participation banking in Turkey and the lesson that the Ethiopian interest-free banking just can learn from the Turkish experience. So as an introduction, as we all know, financial institutions play a pivotal role towards fostering investment and growth in countries through mobilization of financial resources and trying to disseminate or distribute those financial resources in terms of, or in the form of loans and different kinds of financial instruments in order to bolster the growth of countries. So, in all countries, these financial institutions play in order to create a platform or a bridge between savers and depositors. So, specifically in Ethiopia, the banking sector plays very important role towards supporting the growth in the country for the last 100 and more than 100 years. In the form of investment in facilitating investment in the country. When we look at the interest-free financial institutions, by the way, for those who are not familiar with the concept of interest-free banking, interest-free finance, and so on, in different countries they have different names. For example, when we come to Turkey, they use a participation banking or participation finance or Katılım Bankacılık and so on. But in Ethiopia, legally, they are known as interest-free banking or IFB. IFB, mostly for the last 10 years, they have been providing in the form of banking instruments. But in Islamic banking literature, mostly they are known as Islamic banking. In some countries, they call them ethical banking, community banking, and so on. So interest-free banking or the financial institutions play also a very important role towards financial inclusion and economic empowerment, because most of the citizens or people who are religious sensitive might be distanced themselves from involving in the banking and financial activities. So in order to attract and in order to include those people who are far away from these financial institutions, this interest-free banking or interest-free financial institutions in general can be a good choice, or it can be a very important thing to attract those people towards the development and growth of countries. So when we see the financial sector in Ethiopia, the financial sector generally, consists of banks, insurance companies, and financial institutions. And maybe as you might have heard, maybe capital market is also in the pipeline. The regulation regarding the establishment of capital market has been ratified and accepted by the parliament, I think. And right now, currently there are 18 banks, including two state-owned and 16 private banks. And we have also insurance companies, one is state-owned and the other private, and we have more than 41 microfinance institutions, including state-owned, private, and NGOs. When we look at the banking sector in general, the state-owned Commercial Bank of Ethiopia covers almost 57 and more than half of the market share in terms of deposit mobilization compared to the 43% of the private sector. In terms of loans, CB has the highest share. But in terms of profit, recently the private banks have taken over by registering almost 54% of the total profit market share. In terms of foreign exchange mobilization, of course, CB has the lion's share. Right now, close to 20 new banks are currently under formation. So the total number of banks in Ethiopia will be more than 43 or more than that. When we look at the interest-free banking in Ethiopia, we have more than 10 banks which are providing interest-free banking services since 2013. And in order to give just a very brief example, Commercial Bank of Ethiopia has generated more than 32 billion in interest-free deposits. And the other, of course, some of the conventional bank promoted their services from windows to branches. And right now, we can see a lot of huge branches in different parts, including the business hub at Ithaca and other regional cities. As a full-fledged banking service, Zamzam Bank became the first full-fledged bank in Ethiopia after a long and tiring challenge, and Hijra Bank was supposed to join the sector. So when we look at the Turkish banking sector in general, right now we have 54 banks, and 34 of them are deposit taking and portfolio development investment and future participation banks. So the one we are talking about is six participation banks, and I think three of them are state-owned, as far as I know, and the others are, I think, of them are foreign-based, foreign countries, foreign investors owned, and one of them has a listed shareholders. I think it's better to move to the other part, because my main point is about actually the lesson. So I think when I move to the lessons, which are very important in my presentation, the lesson that the interest-free banking sector in general, or in particular in the government, the regulators, and in general the government organs, can learn from the Turkish interest-free banking sector, and in general the Turkish participation, the Turkish banking sector in general, we can learn strong commitment within the legal and regulatory framework. It has been just, you know, a long, or it has been a serious problem in the Ethiopian banking sector, because there was no commitment towards improving or supporting the interest banking sector. For a long time, the government of Ethiopia, specifically the Central Bank of Ethiopia, was not committed just to allow or to make the level playing field, you know, to be comfortable for interest-free banking services. But right now, in the last 2 or 3 years, we can see, you know, relatively better commitment towards improving and supporting the sector, the subsector, we can call it. So the participation banks have expanded their customer base by benefiting the development of financial technology. Of course, unfortunately, in Ethiopia, the financial technologies are not improved well. So, but there are a lot of things that, I mean, there are really changes, I mean, these days, towards improving those financial technologies in order to support the financial transactions and activities in the country. But the other one can be producing skilled manpower. As you know, in Turkey, there are different universities and training centers that support or that train and produce skilled manpower to support these interest-free or participation banking activities and participation banking, participation finance in general. The other one, the research and development. There are also different research centers that lend a hand to this subsector through producing different research results and development activities. The other one can be strong, healthy, and sustainable growth and profit. Of course, banks without growth, or banks without countries' growth, is nothing. So, of course, in one way or another, the growth of the bank can be can play a very important role, or can have a positive impact on the growth of the country, and the growth of the country also can support the process of, or the performance of the bank. So right now, the participation banking, some participation banks are, and we can see a lot of good performance in growth in terms of deposits, and so providing financing activity, in terms of exchange rate activities, and other banking services. When we see the advantage of these interest-free banks or participation banks in Turkey, we can see that they have a very positive impact on the production and employment by providing investment through boost and financing. So, as we know, these participation banks do not give, you know, customers a loan, I mean, in terms of money or in terms of cash. Okay, rather, they support the investment and production through providing asset-based financing, or partnership-based financing in terms of mudaraba and musharaka. And when we come to the asset base, we can mention murabaha and ijara concepts or financial instruments. The other can be allocate resources to finance foreign exchange earning services, which is very important because without export, we cannot reduce the deficit of the country or the current account deficit or the trade deficit and so on. So as we know, Ethiopia has also a very huge deficit current account deficit. So in order to eliminate or in order to reduce this deficit, production and investment is very important. In order to promote this production investment, interest-free banks can play a very important role. The other can be support the development of foreign trade by providing foreign exchange flows into the country, which is also a very serious problem in our country, in Ethiopia. We have very low
exchange reserve.
Yes?
Doctor, I'm sorry. You have last 2 minutes, please.
Okay, I'm about to finish. Okay. So in order to support our foreign exchange inflows, these banks also can play a very important role because if there is investment, if these banks support long-term investment, those long-term investments can support this foreign exchange by increasing or boosting the exports of the country. And the last but not the least, transitioning the informal economy to formalization, which is an important issue in the country. Not only in Ethiopia, but also, in Turkey also, there is a huge informal economy, which is financial transactions or the economic activities which are out of the formal financial institutions. So in Ethiopia, very, very large amount of transactions are out of the banking sector or out of the what we call it formal financial institutions. So in order to formalize or in order to bring those informal activities or informal financial activities into the formal or legal or the normal financial institution, these banking service or these banking these institutions are very, very crucial to make the economy strong by bringing or by attracting those informal transactions into the formal financial institutions. So unfortunately, we could say something more, but due to the time constraint, I have to stop here, and maybe there is in the Q&A sessions we can mention maybe data we couldn't include in this part. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Dr. Abdu, for your nice presentations. Now we'll have questions and answering and discussion sessions from the participants. If you have questions, please raise your hand and mention, refer it to the presenters, and you can ask your questions. I hope the hostess will help us with the organizing the question and the discussion sessions. Thank you. If you have questions or suggestions or anything you want to mention, you can raise your hand and ask.
Can I ask a question, Mr. Chairman?
Yes, please go on.
Okay. First of all, I would like to thank you, both presenters, Idris and Dr. Abdu, for their very nice presentation. My first question is to Mr. Idris, and he just discussed the theories of secularisms. Actually, even if it's not my field, but we came across these issues so many times, and we will see sometimes when secularism is mixed with the individual characters. Okay, so we are sometimes confused, even myself. What is the boundary between state secularism, and also is that related with personality of someone? maybe someone may practice his religion, or he may act according to his culture or trend or norm. And sometimes this is used to maybe abuse people's rights with respect to religion. What is the boundary and how this is misused actually, whether it is in Ethiopia or maybe in another country's experience? If you say something on this one, I'm very happy. My second question is to Dr. Abdu. He's one of the experts in the area. I have a question on the difference of the Islamic banking sector of those who are newly joining the market, and also those are available in the conventional banks. Okay, when you go to Ethiopia right now, there is a huge marketing of even the conventional banks to participate in their Islamic banking windows. What is advantage and disadvantage between these two groups? Another question is,
I think Dr. Abdul Fattah has lost the connections.
May I ask?
Yes, please go on until it comes back.
Okay. First of all, I will thank all presenters. My question to Mr. Idris is, in Ethiopia, it was a long time since the state and religion were separated by constitution, but we see sometimes when the government interferes in the religious affairs, how we can get rid of these problems is my question. My second question is to Dr. Abdu. That is, while many groups and peoples are running to be benefited from the opportunity of this interest-free bank, many banks are being emerged in this aspect. How can we control the quality or the standards of this bank so that it can serve the people and the government? My question. Thank you so much.
May I ask you, please? Thank you, doctor. Yes, please go on. Dr. Abdul Fattah, I'll give you the chance to ask again. Please forgive me for that. Mr. Wakar, you can go on.
Okay, thank you very much. If I'm allowed to ask, first of all, I'd like to thank the presenters for their informative presentations. And my question goes to the first presenter, Mr. Idris. So my question is, you raised various important issues, particularly the extent to which the post-EPRDF regime adopted this secularism as one of its building blocks. So my question is, currently, Ethiopia's political discourse, as it stands today, actually it is near to those who think that Ethiopia was a great nation under one language, one religion, and the like, whereas the regime that you discussed actually acknowledged the existence of diversified religion and identities. And so in the current situation in the country indicates that the political forces in competition can be simply categorized into the federalist and the unitarist, whereas most of the federalist forces are particularly out of this upcoming national election. The other segment of the political forces are just getting ready for the national election, if any. So what kind of fears do you have? What kind of challenge in the prospectus can you see as an expert in the area, given the current political discourse of Ethiopia? Do you think that we can have the secular state or the secular Ethiopia that you are aspiring to have? Thank you. That's my question.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Wakari. Dr. Abdel Fattah, you can ask your last questions. And then I will give a chance to another person. But...
You can give the chance when the internet is dropped. I just forget the question. Sorry for that.
Okay, it's okay. Any other questions from the participant?
I have a question, Mr. Mufti.
Okay, Dr. Abdullah, please go on.
My question is really to focus to the first presenter, which is His Excellency Ambassador, here is, if she is around.
Can I forward my... is not here now, but I'm not sure.
Okay. If there is no other related person to the her issue, I have a remark, if you allow me.
Okay, Dr. Abdullah, I will give you the chance at the end of the discussion sessions. Please wait for a minute. Any other questions from the participants? I think there is no questions, so I'll directly move to, I'll give the chances to Mr. Idris Makonnins to answer the raised questions, and then I'll pass to Dr. Abdul. Please, Mr. Idris Makonnin, you can go on.
Thank you so much. The colleagues have raised important questions. I would like to address them just one after the other. So the first question raised by Dr. Abdel Fattah has some concerns whether the secularism I talk about will affect individual freedom, freedom to religion, freedom to believe, and also freedom to practice religious beliefs. So I would like to now entangle two issues related to secularism. So the first one is the idea that some scholars in the Enlightenment sphere would like to see the secularism that has to be introduced and adopted by the state. And that is what they call it, secularization of society. So in order to have a successful society vis-a-vis the state, then the state has to impose some sort of secular thoughts on its citizens, so that the state can have unrivaled autonomous over its citizens, then the more the society is secularized, the more the society is changed or transformed into a uniform society, then peace can prevail, state can prosper, democracy can flourish. And this is the idea of secularizing society, or the secularization of society. I'm not talking about the idea of secularizing the society. I'm not talking about the idea of imposing some sort of ideology vis-a-vis the belief that any individual citizen can have. That's not my call and also my interest to talk about. In fact, this theory, secularization theory, is one of the failed theories in the discipline of social theories, or
I think you have muted your microphone, Mr. Idris McKenna.
Okay, am I in now?
Yes.
Thank you so much. So the secularization theory vis-a-vis society is a failed theory. In fact, now religion and religious practices are soaring, exponentially increasing across the world. Religion is gaining back the ground to disprove the theory of secularization of society. I am talking about the secularization of the state. I'm talking about secularism from the state level, where there are important principles that the state has to take into serious consideration as far as isolating itself from intervening in any religious matters, to leave the religious matters to the believers, to give free ground so that to establish free ground so that religion can flourish and religious practice can easily be practiced by the adherents of individual religions. So when it comes to the idea of secularism that I'm advocating, I'm calling for, particularly in relation to the Ethiopian state, then then the state has to be secularized in a sense. Religion, the state should remain as neutral as possible. Then there are two different spheres here where the state can run its own affair and religious communities can also run their own affair. Then there is a line that links the state to the with the society or the religious communities, and that has to be based on the deliberations, the discussions these two different actors can have and formulate the model that their relation can go smoothly without any kind of problem for that matter. If this is the case, then no single individual has to worry whether the state can infringe his or her own religious matter or practice or whatever, or for that matter, religious beliefs. And this case actually should work at the same time for the segments of the polity or the political society that constitutes a particular state with no religion, with no faith. Disbelievers or people or citizens with no any kind of religion, affiliated to any kinds of religion, has to benefit from this kind of a model of secularism that I'm calling for. So that is the first question. The second question raised by Dr. Junaidi is the practice that we have been witnessing for almost 20 plus years now, that the state continues to interfere or intervene in the religious matter of its own citizens, and particularly the Ethiopian Muslims have remained the primary victims of this interventions. So this intervention, I believe, is attributed to the lack of a particular model that has to be employed in order to manage the state religion relationship, the kind of relationship that these two actors can have. We don't have this kind of model. This situation gives immense opportunity for the state to intervene into the religious matters in the Ethiopian Muslims in particular. So if we are able to devise a particular viable model that will help to keep our distance, the distance that should exist between the state and the religious communities, then I don't expect these kinds of interventions will perpetuate, will continue. So I suggest we need to bring forward a viable model so that we will not have any more these interventions coming from the state particularly. And the secularism I'm talking about is against any form of interventions by the state against any religious community. As far as the third question raised by Brother Wagari is key, very relevant. I'm highly concerned by the evolving political discourse that has a lot of implications. It's going to affect every corner of life that was supposed to flourish after the political reconfiguration that is undertaking after 1991. Now, if we analyze the reigning discourse, the discourse that the current regime, the current government is pursuing and working on, it is really problematic. We need to take that unfortunate discourse into serious consideration. And the number one implication this discourse will have will be the separation of the state and religion. The discourse that is now very prominent in the current political engagement back in Ethiopia is in favor of one particular culture, one particular religion, and so forth. So this is an important time that we need to consider devising a particular model of secularism that fits the Ethiopian polity context so that we will not go back to the kind of political atmosphere where one particular society or religion will benefit more and the other religious communities will face the unfortunate marginalization. So this is quite an important time that we need to bring forth the discussion of having a kind of model of secularism that fits the context on the ground. Thank you so much.
This for your answering the questions. I hope the participants got the enough answers for the questions. Now, please, Dr. Abdu, you can go on answering your questions.
Okay, thank you. I think there are two questions raised on my presentation. The first one is about the difference between the interest-free banking, I think full-fledged, I think you want to say, the full-fledged banking and the windows which are provided by the conventional banks. So as far as I know, the first difference can be the institutional aspect. So as we know, the windows are organized or established by the already functioning conventional banks. For example, when we say CBE or Commercial Bank of Ethiopia, conventional banks or branch, we mean that the owner is the conventional bank itself. So this is the first and the most important difference, because when we look at, for example, when we say Zamzam Bank, we mean that the owners are the shareholders, and the shareholders have already bought shares in different amount to establish this full-fledged bank. So at the outset, from the beginning, the full-fledged banks are established by the shareholders from the beginning. So there is no, of course we cannot be sure about that, but there is no like interest-based income or interest-based capital to establish this institution. So the first thing is the institutionalization aspect. The second one, until recently, the funds between the conventional and the windows or the interest-free windows were together, intermingled, okay? But, you know, due to some like criticisms, we can say, or complaints from different parties or people, they were forced to just separate the funds, okay? Like, for example, those who have been collected or deposited in the form of amana, wadia, or, you know, different kinds of deposits will be used to finance only those who are interest-free financing activities. So there was a segregation of funds, what we call it segregation of funds. Right now, of course, you know, which is a very important move, which is the establishment of a full-fledged branch. So right now, those interest-free branches just will only take deposits in the form of interest-free deposits, or what we call it amana, wadia, and mudaraba, and they extend different kinds of financing in the form of musharaka and mudaraba. Of course, which is very serious. Still, it's critical because we can just, you know, talk a lot about that, but unfortunately, we don't have time. So these are briefly the difference between these two institutions or different banking services. The other one is advantage and disadvantage of this group. Of course, both of them have disadvantage for the economy of the, the growth of the country, because both of them attract or include those who have been distanced or were excluded from the financial activities, or from the economic transactions. So what I mentioned before, those informal economy, generally in developing countries, there is a huge informal economy or informal financial transaction. So and most of them were, according to the IMF and World Bank research or findings, there are a lot of people who have been excluded from the financial sector due to religious reasons. Okay, so the establishment of this kind of financial institutions and services by itself can embrace a lot of people toward the financial sector, which is a very important move and which is very advantageous for the growth and development of the countries. The other one can be, the other question is, how can we control the quality of the bank to serve the people, which is very critical question. The first one is, I think these banks should know that they are involving in a market where there is a very huge or serious competition, because, you know, this is business. Okay, banking is a business. So in business, there is, especially in free market and, you know, or partially or slightly free market sector or free market system, we always expect a very rivalry and a very serious competition. So how can we get out of this competition, or how can we gain or benefit from this competition? The first one is strengthening the capital, the capital of the banks. Maybe you hear that there are, very huge banks are coming to the sector, maybe with a very, an amount of like 5 to 8 billion their capital, which is very, very amazing and which is serious. So these banks should work very hard in order to strengthen their amount of capital. because you know you can survive in the sector or you can survive in the industry as long as you you become competent in the business. Otherwise, you'll be kicked out of the sector. The other one is, of course, the other very important, I think, a lesson or move that the banks should take is improving the service. Service quality is very important. So if you improve your service quality, you can attract a lot of customers. And if you attract a lot of customers or depositors, that means you can boost your financing. If you boost your financing, you can get a very high profit. That's all. So, but how can you improve the service quality? Of course, through improving the state of art technology. So technology plays very important role towards improving the service quality. So like, you know, what we call, there is a concept that what we call it fintech, financial technology. So through developing and improving and through integrating the banking sector and the banking services through this state-of-the-art technology, we can attract very large number of customers and beneficiaries, and at the end, ultimately, we can get the target of a profit. We can collect profit, and we can be sustainable. So sustainability is very crucial in the banking sector. As long as we just stay in this competitive sector, so this is what I can say. Thank you all.
Thank you very much, Dr. Abdu, and both our presenters. We have finalized these sessions of presenting discussions also. Our third presenters were not able to participate because of some health problems. We wish him easy recovery. Now I'll give a chance to Dr. Abdullah Kadir for giving some additional remarks. Please, doctor, it is your turn. You can go on.
Jazakallah khair, brother Mufti. My voice is coming to you.
Yes.
Can you hear me?
Yes.
Jazakallah khair. First of all, I want to appreciate all the participants, the organizer, first of all. I am part of the organizer. So since I am the elder member of ORDA, and this session is very astonishing. Yesterday, I attended all the sessions, the framework of the session. Yesterday, generally, concerned about the East Africa in general, and they come today to the, particularly on Ethiopia. This category of organizing the session is also appreciable. My big remark on the secularism is, in short, our brother said secularization of the society. This, I want to remind my brother, secularization of society is, impossible in this in general. But the, as he said, the state men and the system of the state must be secular. But the society of Ethiopia are, as you know, very strong in religious concern. So the issue is making people of the government secular, do not interfere in the religious affairs. The very recent example is what has been done last week in the General Assembly meeting of Supreme Council of Ethiopian Islamic Affairs. Two controversial action has been taken. One, the security of Addis Ababa city gives permission to the hotel after 3 hours. The federal police come and the This is one example of the people are controversial in practicing the secularism of the state itself. That is what I want to remind our brother on this point. The other issue is, you know, Excellency Ambassador is here. The
Doctor, we apologize for the interruptions. I think there are some technical problems. Now you can continue.
Yeah. My comment is, you know, on the historical and the cultural relationship of Turkey and Ethiopia. You know, yesterday I attended very astonishing and very valuable presentation of our brother who make trace of historical background starting from 13th or 14th century to the end of the Minelik era. This is very important. I call up our students to come to this. If you allow me, I will show you a very important point on my short letter I wrote to the Islamic Affairs of Turkey, that is Diyanet. Can I show you some remark on this? Just 1 minute, yeah. Can you allow me to present my
please, can you help you, Dr. the host?
Yes. Concerning the issue of Ethiopia and Turkey, the historical background is very strong. If you come to the point of you know, 16th century, Özdemir Pasha is historical person who must be taught his career and his endeavor in East Africa and to our students, and coming to that to the existence of Ottoman empires in East Africa. You see here how many. Excuse me, almost 49 Baylor Bear ruled East Africa at that time. This is a very huge historical event, must be studied. Our student must come to this point and make analysis of this part of history. In this regard, I call up our student to read this book, that is Habash Reality. Edited and presented by Jenkins or Honlu. I suggest ORDA can have this book and translated in the local language of Ethiopia, because it has got almost 3rd century history events in its content. The other very important issue is Bilal Habashi. Bilal Habashi is now, you know, out of 57 Islamic countries, only Turkey or Turkish people mention Bilal Habashi in every session of the prayer, where the big mosques in Turkey, in every azan, after azan, they salutate or make dua to Hazrat Bilal radiallahu anhu. This issue must be have a very important concern in to ORDA to make this historical personnel strongly articulated in Ethiopian historical studies and researches, as well as making us this personnel viable in the term of what you call the memorial status to him, not a status of like Heikel, no, to make institutions by his name, like International University of Bilal, as the executive manager of Ethiopian Scholars Forum in abroad. I call up ORDA to participate in this project. This project intended to make Bilal al-Habashi have name in international university in Addis Ababa, and the other campus, inshallah, ta'ala, will be in Harar. That is what I want to mention in this regard. Thank you, barakallahu fikum. I appreciate your career, and I am disappointed by the number of participants. How many hundreds of students are here in Turkey, but only 38 students are participating, people are participating. This must not be passed without mentioning. That is what I want to say. Jazakumullah khair. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Thank you very much, Dr. Abdullah, for your precious additional remarks and notes. Thank you very much. Now we're going to our last closing remarks, which will be delivered by ORDA's Vice Chairman, Dr. Aman Saddo Elemo. Please, Dr. Aman, the mic is yours. You can continue.
Okay. Sesim geliyor mu? Is my voice coming?
Geliyor doktor. Devam edebilirsiniz.
All right. Her şeyin başlangıcı olduğu gibi bitişi de olmalı diye düşünüyorum. As we have managed to have a very good start yesterday, I hope, you know, having a very good finish is also a part of the activity. When making this concluding remark, I would have to say important few things. And then before that, the guests of honor we have had during this 2 days presentations, conferences, Your Excellency Yaprak Alp, the ambassador of Turkey to Ethiopia, and also permanent representative to African Union. She was with us. And then Your Excellency Professor Dr. Mehmet Bulut, the whole day, yesterday and today, they are with us, who is the rectorate of Istanbul's Sabahattin Zami University and president of ADAM, and the Excellency Mr. Wendy Mugazahin, who is the Ethiopia's Consulate General in Istanbul. They made the opening speech. And we had also Excellency Lelise Duka, who is the Commissioner of Oromia Tourism Commission. Respected ORDA chairpersons, research participants, academicians, participants on Zoom and online, this is a special moment for all of us. ORDA was established in 2018 by students and then graduates who are in Turkey. These are Ethiopian students and graduates. It's only 3 years now, so we are able to organize the second conference, and this time the conference is an international conference. So the beauty of this is we are discussing on how we can strengthen the relationship between Turkey and East Africa, and primarily emphasizing on the past, the present, and the future multidimensional relationship between these two regions. So I hope during these 2 days discussions, the important research papers which would help us get an insight on the multidimensional relationship already covered in the team. And also, I hope that we have figured out what we need to do to further strengthen the already existing relationship. So one step ahead, we are supposed to come up as well with the important research workers which might further strengthen, further add value to this already long-lasting relationship. And Mr. Mrs. Yaprak Alp, who is the ambassador of Turkey, underlined that the especially the Ethiopian-Turkey relationship is not a new relationship. As during this year, 125th year of Turkey-Ethiopia bilateral relationship was celebrated, and this means a lot. So we invite interested academicians, stakeholders, to pay attention to this long-lasting relationship through sponsoring, through directly engaging in research works, maybe through putting this as an important input into the policies of these countries as well. So having said this, the 2 days conference, which started on April 3, 2021, jointly organized with Ankara Düşünce Araştırma Merkezi, which is ACTR, Ankara Center for Thought and Research. This time, this is for the ORDA second in the conference, but for ADAM-ACTR, it is the 15th international conference. So during these conferences, there are special people, special organizations we need to thank. And primarily, we have to express our, we have to extend our thanks to ADAM for co-organizing this research. It wouldn't have been possible in their huge participation in this international conference. And special thanks has to be for the YETEBE for financing this conference generously. So, it wouldn't have been possible if the research team of other research and development association, together with all its members, haven't done in this conference, if they haven't done what this conference deserves. All right. So finally, I would have to extend my thanks to people who have attended this conference online and also through their participation on Zoom platform. And what I would finally would like to say is this is not the end. Every year we would be planning to do international conferences which attracts the interests of researchers, academicians, and stakeholders in terms of four pillar areas which ORDA focuses on. And one is, as this conference emphasized, it is the strengthening of the East Africa, and specifically Ethiopia and Turkey relationship. And the second one is working on the capacity building of students studying in Turkey, so that as they graduate, they would be able to organize these sorts of conference. They would be able to come up with research works that would solve practical problems experienced in the country, and as well as countries which are in very good relationship with East Africa, with Ethiopia as well. And this, the other point is the capacity building we're working on is not limited to conferences. There are seminars going on every week. So we would like to see you or having your ideas presented to these audiences. So that is what I would like to remark before winding up the presentation. And the trade relationship is also what was emphasized during this presentation. We need to come up on how we can scale up the relationships as, in terms of adding value to the trade relationship between East Africa and Turkey. So people, especially university students, academicians, who are largely from East Africa, or people who would like to contribute to the East African economy and the economy of Turkey, and as well as the multidimensional relationship between these regions, they are encouraged to be with us. We will be willing to work with you as ORDA, and then we are always open as far as it contributes, as far as your ideas, your works, your researches, your advices, your grants, as far as they contribute to this relationship between Turkey and East Africa, where we will be always welcoming. So we will be willing to see you in the forthcoming conferences. This is what I would like to say. And I hope we will have several conferences of this sort. We will have, this wouldn't be the final concluding remark of the conferences ORDA and then ADAM would organize. And we will have in the future several related conferences. Until that, I wish you a good time. Thank you for being with us. Thank you for your presence.